Let's talk about the five questions, and then we'll have a little group discussion after that. What time? Time series or line plot? Okay, great. So, in a sentence or two, what is roughly being displayed here? Obviously, I haven't given you the whole article, which describes what's going on here, but the plot pretty much stands by itself. What would you guess this article was about? Someone here?
Drawing spurious conclusions from data?
No, the article is not about that, but it's the article was using this plot to kind of support the thesis of or the principle that they were trying to describe. So what I'm asking is what principle might have been described using this plot?
The effects of a mobile phone on the rate of kidnapping.
And what effect?
Increasing mobile phones seems to decrease kidnapping.
Okay, and if it was a cause and effect relationship, if mobile phone usage increases, led to increasing kidnapping, what might be the causal, like the actual cause and effect part that caused that? Like, why would kidnappings drop as there's more mobile phone tech?
You can track it, huh?
Yeah, people are carrying cell phones with them, like the GPS units that may be able to make a call before their cell phone is taken away from them. So any of those mechanisms might describe why. Like Elliot was saying back there, it may be a spurious correlation, but if you had to try and imagine what the actual cause and effect steps are, those might be one mechanism that people are able to make a call before their phone is taken away. Now, we spoke about a different type of plot in the class last time that shows cause and effect. Which one? Okay, scatter plots, yeah. And how, if you had to plot that data, replot that graph, say pick up a few points from 98, 2000, 2004, 2008, just 4 or 5 points, what would a scatter plot look like? Rather than using a line plot as the economist has shown here, if you had to redraw that same data as a scatter plot, what would the general shape look like at the points? Firstly, let's decide what goes on in the x-axis. What would you plot on the x-axis, perhaps? No, we're talking scatter plots. So time series plots, you plot time on the x-axis. Okay, so you could put the mobile phone antenna there on the x-axis, and on the y-axis, the kidnappings per 100,000 people. So then, if the y-axis is kidnappings, and the x-axis is mobile phone antenna, what would the scatter plot look like? And K for kidnappings, and they're both conveniently go between 0 and 10. So in 2008, the value for mobile phones is in red would be around about 8, and its corresponding value of kidnappings is about 1. So we can keep going back, and we'll probably get a shape. There are a few unusual points here at the beginning where this correlation doesn't hold. So we're seeing that negative correlation in the scatter plot as well. Okay. So in the last class, I had said cause and effect relationships are best shown on a scatter plot. We can quickly see that our mobile phone penetration is negatively correlated with kidnappings. But in The Economist, they've chosen to show a line plot, and I like it as well. But what advantage is there of showing it as a time series plot than a scatter plot?
You see the relationship over time.
Exactly. But the moment you go to a scatter plot, you lose that third variable, time. Right? We're actually dealing with three variables here, even though you think there's two. You're dealing with kidnappings, mobile phone penetration, and time. There's three variables implicitly going on We know that. The x-axis is time, and then we've got two other variables. Right? So there are three variables. The moment you go to the 2D scatter plot, you lost that third variable time. So keeping it as this form, as the economist is using, is beneficial. You get that time trend. You also see up here, the correlation holds well from about 2002 onwards. There's that strong X that you see. But earlier on, you don't actually see that. There's a positive correlation. If you only had the data from 2000 prior available, there's a positive correlation. So that's why you get a few things that actually go in that direction initially, and then only you get the negative correlation after that. And that's what you commonly see in engineering data. Variables are generally negatively correlated, for example, but it's easy to find periods of time where that correlation is actually the opposite. So keeping it in a time series plot also has an advantage. Okay? Good. So that's just a recap of some of the concepts from last time. So I've got all the assignments. Okay. So we'll move on to the today's material. I know a few of you didn't get the notes, but most of you gave the notes principles the way they applied. Good. So, just a couple of announcements. Firstly, thanks very much to those of you that have submitted logos for the course website. I've got a few submissions. There's a few more days left before that, and of course, there's a copy of Box Hunter and Hunter available for the best logo. I'll put a few of the submitted logos on the website around the 18th of Jan, so that you all can see what everyone else has submitted. I'll put it anonymously. And then we can vote on it on the next box. Also, the grad preview applications that I spoke about last time, that's now closed on Friday. But maybe if you missed it, you can probably speak to Dr. Schwartz nicely and he may still let you submit your application. The office hours started from last week already from 9:30 to 2:30. Myself and the suit are available in JHE 342. And the forum had a little bit of a glitch this week. I got the mailing list very late and I set it up in a hurried way. But how many of you got an email with your username and password? Okay, so most of you did not get an email. Is that right? So your username is your first name space last name. So in my case, it would be Kevin space Dunn. You don't have to use capitals, but the important thing is there has to be a space in the middle. Okay, not an underscore, but just a space. So that's your username, and your password is your student number. If it begins with a zero, you need to add a zero as well. And then you can log in and change your password, you can change your avatar, you can customize your profile, whatever you want. And so in the future, this past week I was happy to answer emails from people directly, but going forward I prefer you post to the website first. That way everyone can see what the issues are as well and help each other out. And then another announcement is I've been getting a lot of emails and submissions calling me Dr. Dunn. I'm not a doctor, so just call me Kevin. I don't have a PhD, so just keep it informal. Okay, what we're going to cover today is probably most of the top part, and we'll hopefully get to about the Olivia test and significance, and maybe we'll touch on confidence. So, as I said in the last class, I'll always start with a few examples. The first one is coming to this idea of the batch reactor. So, I mentioned the batch reactor last week, where at the end of the reaction, you get a yield value. So, a yield, say, 85%, which means you've recovered 85% of your product, or whatever the number is. But it's a particular number, and you've got data on that single number for the last 3 years. So, plenty of data. How do you characterize that number? What sort of distribution does it have? That's the sort of thing we're going to look at today. And then if yesterday's yield was less than 50%, what are the chances of that happening? So given historical data, what are the probabilities of other future events happening? This next example, unfortunately, we won't get to it in the class, but it will be in the notes. It's when you use the Poisson distribution to determine failure. So the Poisson distribution is great for modeling unusual events, events that happen very infrequently. So for example, the pump data. You've got historical failure data on your plant for all the pump units. What is the probability that three pumps will break down this month? That's something you can model with the Poisson distribution. Or very commonly we'll get this scenario here. So where your manager asks, what is the difference between reactor 1 and 2? Does it have a better final purity than reactor 2? Or there's all sorts of examples. Is case A better than case B? Is material A better than B? Is method B better than A? So those sorts of binary alternatives. And then the last one is, if you have a customer asking you what is the confidence interval for your product, say perhaps the density of the powder you're reading, or the impurities that they're going to be receiving, what does that mean? What does that confidence interval mean? How do you interpret it? And we'll look at that. Again, as mentioned in the notes, this section is purely a recap. I don't do justice at all to the level of detail that's needed to understand some of these tools. So please look at some of the textbooks, both Box Hunter and Hunter, and the last one, Montgomery and Romeo, on reserve in the library. So if you feel that you don't quite get everything, this is just a review class. You're expected to have covered most of this material in the prior course. So just go over those details if you need to. And then here's a checklist of concepts. By the end of this section, so this is section 2 of the course, we'll spend about 2 weeks on this section today and next class. By the end of this section, you need to be able to understand these concepts and be extremely comfortable using it, because they're in all the next sections after that. Everything just builds on all these concepts. Okay, so this is a pretty stupid graph to put up. When I was asked to teach this course sometime October last year, then I came back from my vacation, I started working on it. This is where I was going to start the course, and then I added the visualization section in as to start it instead. But then this is where I was going to start the course and say, well, this would likely be pretty boring without variability. In fact, you wouldn't need to take this course. I wouldn't have a job. Most engineers wouldn't have a job if there weren't variation. But it seems silly to have this up, and I'll get to it in a minute, but this is what we strive for. This is what we wish we had in our plants. If you walked into your chemical plant, you wish you could see flat lines, that everything's going on target, there's no change in anything, everything is just perfect. But we don't have that. What we do have is lots and lots of variability due to different sources. And let's take a look at what some of those are. I mean, there's a lot of sources that we can explain, but the moment we can't explain anything, we put that down to error. These are usually things like physical principles for our chemical process that we don't understand. We'll just call that error. It's not a negative term, like in English when you say your assignment has an error in it. That doesn't mean that. It just means things we don't know, and that we lump up in just this term called error. So despite the fact that we'd like a flat line, say here at about 1,680, we have error, unexplained phenomena, up and down around that value. Feedback control. Think a bit about what a feedback control system does. You've got your process over here, we call G often, and then we take some sort of measurement on it, and we feed back a value, and we inject a new change into our process. So often we'll call this Y, and we'll call this U. So we inject some sort of input into our process. That input that we're manipulating our process with, the manipulated variable, is causing variability. We're changing control systems, or the control loops are doing it automatically, but we're introducing variance into our process. That's another form. And I'll talk a bit about this in a bit. The other way is an operator. A process operator sitting in the control room is nothing more than a feedback controller. He sees or she sees things on the charts, they react to those events, and they manually make changes to the process. They set new set points, they make adjustments to the plan. But an operator is also a form of feedback control or feed-forward control. They're injecting variance into the process by changing things on the plan. Other forms of error that you'll see are with our sensors. We measure temperature, for example, and that temperature sensor isn't perfect. It's going to have the odd spike, the noise on the sensor as well. We'll have to recalibrate it periodically. And there's also this drifting around. So you'll see this measurement moves up and down. Even though it should be measuring 1,680, it's measuring this drifted temperature around the target. So that's very common to see, that sort of variability in our data. Another form of variability is the raw materials. We get a batch of raw materials from our supplier, and we'll be working on that raw material. Perhaps it comes from, if we're dealing with fresh milk, it will be the milk from that day. And we'll process that milk for the next 6 hours, and then we'll get another batch of milk in from the other farm. And as that new batch of milk comes in, the cows from that other farm are eating different types of grass. That milk has slightly different properties. So our raw material coming into the process has got variability in it. And we're constantly changing raw material batches. And you'll see variability in our process. Often, it's well known, for example, in petroleum refineries, that as the batch of crude comes in from one oil field in Saudi Arabia, and then the next batch starts to be processed, the whole plant moves to an entirely different operating point. All the temperatures shift, the whole distillation column profile kind of moves up, because everything, your whole raw material profile has shifted, the whole plant needs to shift to compensate for that. So our raw materials inject variance. The external or ambient temperature, humidity, that also is a form of disturbance to our process. If there's a sudden rain shower or snowstorm and our heat exchangers get this large amount of heat taken away from them, it causes a very sudden spike. So, for example, something like that in the cooling profile. Or if a piece of equipment breaks down, you get flat lines or plant shutdowns, planned or unplanned. There's tons of this. This is a pretty realistic chart of what you would see if you had to go to a typical chemical plant and ask for data for the past 500 data points. You'll see all sorts of garbage, spikes and drifts and flat lines. When really what you're interested in is this. You're not interested in that piece, you're not interested in that piece, and so on. You have to go do a lot of manual cleaning before you can actually start to use the data. So this is typical of what you'd see. And it keeps us employed, but it comes with a price. Okay. So, as I said at the start, we love flat lines. But flat lines are just not going to happen. So, let's take a look at what happens. I'm going to make two assertions here. The customers want they want uniformity and low cost. So, they want a very uniform product at a low price. And if they don't get that, they're probably going to elsewhere. But the inherent variability in our process defeats both those objectives. We'll take a look why. Variability, of course, is not going to give you a uniform product, and it's going to increase your cost. Let's take a look how. Firstly, if your customer is totally unable to use the product, that's the most extreme form. So instead of delivering a batch of fresh milk, this milk is off spec. The customer, Nestle, for example, is going to make ice cream from it. They cannot. So they cannot. That's an extreme form. The viscosity too high. So, for example, all the product, they're trying to run that through their twin screw extruders. They're just totally unable to use that batch of material you deliver to them. The less extreme form is that it just leads to poor performance. So, coming back to the polymer example. Say the melting point is too high. The person processing that batch of plastic has to put in extra energy. It costs them more money to deal with that poor raw material. Or if it's a catalyst that's off spec that you're supplying, maybe your customer needs longer reaction times now. So really, your customer is going to get upset eventually with this. And your brand is going to be diminished. They're going to really start shopping around for alternatives. And believe me, that happens a lot. When you look at pharmaceutical companies, which I've dealt with, they have no problem finding the lowest cost supplier as long as they can get on target product to them. They will switch in a heartbeat. So don't be surprised when you're dealing out there with suppliers. They're going to nail you to the wall to deliver very low cost product and very uniform. And they will switch the moment they find an alternative. An extreme example of that was the listeriosis breakout last year, or 2008 rather, where we all know that there's bacteria in the food we buy. I mean, there's a finite amount, but there's a certain threshold. And above that threshold is just fatal. So that's what happened there. But you have to keep your product within spec and with low variability. You're not going to get to that case. We love it. But every amount of variability we add to our process at all points in the raw materials, feedback control in the middle of the process, wherever this variance is coming from, it's going to cost us money at every step. It's going to cost you also to inspect all of that. So one thing you see especially in production lines where there's a low throughput, is that the inspection costs are phenomenal. So this happens again in pharmaceutical processing, where they'll maybe make a handful of batches a day. They will inspect every single one of those batches before they ship it out and start making tablets with it or whatever the medicinal form is. But it's called testing quality into your product. They test every single batch, and if the batch is off spec, they throw it away. But that's tremendously costly, and you can't scale that up. You can't go to high manufacturing rates by doing that. If your process has low variability, on the other hand, you don't need to inspect every single batch that you're sending off. But you can't spend all your money inspecting all your product either. And producing all spec product is going to cost you, because you're going to have to recycle it through your process, or you're going to have to pay huge environmental disposal fees, or sell it at a loss, or reduce profits. So tons of issues related to variability. And then just to come back to this idea of feedback control, this is flipping it around. You're not producing the product anymore. Imagine you're consuming a product. You're consuming raw materials that are highly variable. If you have a process that has no feedback control, again, this happens in the pharmaceutical area a lot. They don't have feedback control systems on many of their reactors. All that variance in the input goes right through the process and lands up in the product. So if I'm the manufacturer of a pharmaceutical company, I press my suppliers to deliver me low variance product. Because if they deliver me something that's off spec, my final product is going to be off spec. Just because everything coming in just passes right through, gets modified in some way. Perhaps the incoming distribution is this, and the outgoing distribution is this. But still, if this incoming distribution is broader, my outgoing distribution also becomes broader. Everything just flows right through. Now, what is feedback control doing? Feedback control says, well, there's this unusual or highly variable material coming in. And either with feed forward or feedback, but with feedback control, we wait for it to come up to the other end and we see that it's off spec. And then we take corrective action. We introduce variance to counteract the initial variance. But feedback control doesn't come for free. It costs us money to have those controllers installed, to keep them tuned. And the energy, so this is going to cost us money, either through energy input, electrical energy or other form of energy, or materials. This may be the flow rate of some feed stream to counteract that. It's going to cost us. So feedback control is not for free. If we receive highly variable raw materials, it's going to cost us feedback control input to get that distribution coming up narrow. Okay, so I hope by now I've convinced you that variability is just what this whole course is about. And it's going to be our focus for everything we look at. So in the last class, we looked at how to show this variability. In this class, we're going to look at how we can quantify that in some way and then compare it as well. The class, 2 weeks from now, so we'll deal with this section on quantifying and comparing variability for the next 2 weeks. The class after that, section 3, that's going to deal with monitoring charts and how do we track variability. In section 4, the design of experiments, is really looking at how variance in one variable affects another. Kind of like that kidnapping example in cell phones. How does the variability in one variable affect another? And then in section 5, we'll make intentional changes to our process. We'll actually introduce variability into our process in a very specific way to learn more about the process. And then the final section on multivariate data analysis, we'll look at how do we deal with multiple variables to simultaneously extract all that information. Okay, so that's a bit of a background there. Now let's go into the concepts of univariate data analysis and programs and distributions. Histograms are almost so simple that I don't need to explain it to you. It's really just a summary of the variance in the variable you're looking at. But let's just take a look at some terminology here. What we do is we collect a number of samples, and I'm going to assume the discrete case where we've got two categories, in this case male and female, for example. We're looking at the number of children born at McMaster's Hospital last year. Hypothetically, it was 2,739. And that's the balance between male and female. So what we've done is we've taken those 2,700 samples, and we've looked at which category they fall in, male or female, and we count those up and we show them as a bar chart. Simple. We call that a frequency distribution, because it shows the frequency with which events happen. Now, as you would expect, or as you might know, for continuous variables, we don't have categories, so we just create them. On the x-axis, here, let's look at this situation where we're measuring the mass of the package in grams, and this is a line that is aiming to achieve 1 kilogram packages. But because there's variability in the packaging equipment, we have to bias everything up. We're aiming for 1,000 grams, and that's what we're promising our customer. But because we have this huge variability in our packaging equipment, we have to shift our operating point away from 1,000 to a higher value, so that only very few packages are shipped that are below 1,000. So what have we done? We've taken this continuous variable mass, and we've divided it up into chunks of 20 units on this particular example. So 1,000 to 1,020, 1,040, 60, 80, 1,100. And then we just do the same thing. We count up, and we plot it. So whether it's a continuous variable you're looking at or a discrete variable, the same principle applies. And the computer software does this for you, it's brainless. Then, as I said here, if we could reduce that variability, if you could tighten that histogram in, you could really bring that spread in to be narrower. However you do that, you make changes to the packaging equipment so that the variance of the distribution is narrower, then you can start to shift this distribution back to 1,000. So you first squeeze it in and then shift it over to 1,000 so that you're not overfilling each package. That's why being able to visualize your data in this way is also helpful. Okay, so I'm going to give you a couple of minutes, and I'd like you to plot these histograms. Collaborate with the person to the left or the right of you, and just plot what you would expect these histograms to look like. And I'm going to walk around and check these out. Okay, so for the dice example, what would I be plotting on the x-axis? Okay, so one, and the chart, the bar chart. Okay. So we'll as we'll see in the next section, that's just called the uniform distribution. Every bar roughly the same, maybe just a movement. But roughly, give or take, depending on your sample, you throw it 100 times. The sum of those bars to add to 100. So 100, this is going to be about 100 divided 6, approximately, if I throw 100 throws. If I throw 1,000 throws, it's going to be the same thing. Okay, so the next one, lab measurements for the value g. What's on the x-axis?
Number of measurements?
X-axis. And you're working at Stanford where you've got nothing but the best equipment. What does the distribution look like?
Normal.
And what else can you say about the distribution?
That is that equal to 21.
You've got really good equipment.
It'll be narrow.
Perfect. And at McMaster?
Wider.
Even narrow people at the labs are like it. But yeah, normally distributed data,
strict
ones, and peaking at G. Okay. For the grades for a really easy midterm, so we're plotting 100% up here.
Shift it to the right.
Shift it to the right. Okay, so
it's really easy.
So perhaps a couple of 50s. No one's going to get below 50 in this class. Something like that, for example. What about the last one, the bacterial count?
Who's the supplier?
Someone come over here? Which one? Random distribution, all these distributions are following, so like which type? No, okay, maybe you, okay, let's not talk about types of distributions because we're not there at that point. But what would the shape be? Well, firstly, let's take a look at what would the x-axis be? So bacterial count per cubic inch. So let's say we're measuring in the thousands per inch squared. Well, maybe that could be in the millions, who knows what that is. Say we're dealing at maple leaf foods, they've got a criteria from the Health Canada or whatever. No more than that amount. So beyond this point, if they have meat product beyond that point, they have to scrap or make animal food or probably animal food won't. That people treat animals better than humans. But what would this distribution look like on the right hand side? And on the peak, where would it peak? Where would it peak? And would it actually peak or would it come down again? Maybe it does that. Maybe it rises incredibly sharply. Something like that. I'm not sure. I've never looked at it, but something along those lines where there's a certain cut, and maybe even what happens is that this becomes really sharp, so it's almost exponentially kind of decaying, and I'm beyond that point. So what this says is that there's a lot of meat packages with fewer counts of bacteria per cubic inch, but the you don't get many packages with a high bacterial count. Does that, what sort of distributions were people expecting? Normal distributions? No? This is purely hypothetical, right? I have no idea what this data might look like, but I'm just expecting if I was to guess what that distribution would look like, I would expect it to peak at the low end. A lot of packages with very low counts of bacteria, but non-zero. I'd always expect a non-zero on the very low end. Okay, but what are we doing when we're doing this sort of thing, right? We're implicitly saying we're looking at the long-term averages. All those charts that we just drew up there now, without realizing it, you were looking at the long-term probability. So we didn't look at or estimate what the bacterial count was for the last week of production. That distribution may actually look quite different. But when we're looking at populations, so we'll introduce that word now, populations, we're looking at the long-term expectations of that data. So these histograms show those long-term correlations. Here's a few more examples. If someone is pregnant, newly pregnant, they don't know if it's a boy or a girl, but we do know, and Statistics Canada has logged that in Canada there's 1.06 boys born for every girl. And that's typical of every country. There's always more boys born than girls. Unless there's been some experimental practice. If we're having a system where the batch yield is 85%, we don't know what tomorrow's yield is going to be, but over the long term, we know what it's going to be. It's going to be 85 plus or minus 10%. We're using long-term. If you're a female and Statistics Canada said in 2002, you have a 98.86 chance of reaching age 30 or 77.5% chance of reaching age 75. So there's tables for male, there's tables for female, and it's pretty detailed. You can go to their website. There's tables for newborn babies at day 0, 1, 2, 3, up to 100. And then it jumps to 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. It's incredibly detailed, the information. But then an example of throwing a dice. We don't know what the next throw is going to be, but we know that there's a 16.67 chance that it's going to be one of each. Okay, so the idea is that we're dealing with long-term events. Just back to the histograms again, just a technical point. When we plotted those data, we were looking at counts on the y-axis. But we can scale that same histogram. Notice that the two histograms look identical. We just simply scale by the total number n. And then what we have is what we'll call a frequency distribution. This is now the relative frequency distribution. Whereas this is the frequency, this is the relative frequency, or the density as it's sometimes called. When you're looking at that, you don't need to know what n is, the number of samples you used. You can compare it to another distribution. So for example, if I'm looking at batch yields, and I'm working for Petro-Canada in Sarnia, I want to compare batch yields on a similar reactor with my colleague in Calgary. They may have only 2 years of historical data. We have 5 years here in Sarnia. That could be a preferred way of comparing the data. Between companies or between distributions, you go to a relative frequency. And for very large n, that starts to look like the normal distribution. The area, of course, is equal to 1 under that curve. So so that's a pretty straightforward distribution, though. Let's see. How are you guys doing for a break? Do you want, I can go for another 15 minutes now, and then there's a good point to have a break in the notes, or do you want to have a break now? Keep going?
Yes.
OK. So, we'll just introduce some nomenclature here. This is really, remember that earlier chart I showed with all those words coming off it? I'm going to introduce a lot of that terminology here. This should be very comfortable for most. So population is a large collection of potential measurements. We don't necessarily have to make these measurements. It's just a set of potential measurements. And some books say it needs to be infinite. It doesn't. You just need to deal with a large n that will work good enough for our purposes. A sample then, as opposed to population, is actual measurements from the distribution, from the population. So when we did those histograms, we were generating population histograms. We estimated what the population of all packages of nukes from nuclear foods might look like. But then when we go actually take the packages of meat and we measure that bacterial count, that's now a sample of that data. And in engineering, though, we'll often kind of blur the lines between sample and population, because when we just have so much data for a process, as is very easy to do these days, we really have a good enough large sample that we can call that pretty much a population. It starts to approach what a population looks like. So here, I've shown batch yields for the past 5 years, provided we don't go make any drastic changes to that batch. We don't go re-instrument it or change the piping. We can pretty much assume that that 5 years of historical data is going to be our population, even though technically it is a finite sample of, say, 1,000, 600 points. So we will often blur those lines in this class. Whereas if you take a more theoretical stats course, there's a very clear delineation between sampling and population. Probability, we saw there was just the area of the under that curve of the relative frequency distribution. So once you've normalized that distribution to 1, the probability of something happening is the fraction of the area under that curve. That's straightforward. Again, if I show you a distribution of whichever shape, it doesn't matter, say it's something like that, with a heavier tail, and I draw a line, the area under this region, say that's 30%, that represents 30% chance of seeing an event of, in that area, this side of X, and then the balance represents 70%. So the areas are directly related to probability. So again, on your previous histogram, you can go mark what is the area of the probability lower than 80%, and you can just calculate up that area and that would be your probability. So parameters and statistics. Okay, so a parameter is a number that characterizes the distribution, and it's fixed. That's the key point. It's fixed. So if we're looking at the normal distribution, and we'll see this when we get to that section in a minute. So we've got the normal distribution, that peak over there, which we'll call mu, that mu value representing the average is a parameter of the normal distribution. Normal distribution also has another parameter, sigma, which we'll get to after the break. So those two values, those two numbers, which are fixed for the population, are called parameters. Now if we go sample from that population and we estimate mu and sigma, those estimates vary. If I take a sample now and I take a second sample later and then a third sample after that, still every time I'm getting a new estimate of that population parameter. And it varies. So we'll call that a statistic. Okay, then the mean. The mean is what we will call a measurement of location. So there's three ways that we typically use to describe data. We'll, if I've got a historical data, I can describe it by its location, by its spread, and by its distribution. So, and we'll come to all of those again. This one, the location, the mean, just tells us where along the x-axis, shifting left and right, does that center point lie. So it's just the location of that line. And for the population mean, we'll introduce this notation. And E, which means expectation. The expected value of X is defined as mu. So I'm defining my population parameter mu as the expectation of X. So this is some notation you'll see in the course and in stats books, that E is the expected value of X is mu, and it's nothing more than summing up the X's and dividing by. Whereas the sample mean is the approximation of X. So we just take our finite sample, usually a much smaller number, N, and sum those up, and that would be our sample mean. But the mean is not sufficient by itself, right? So if I tell you my batch yields are 85%, that's the average yield. It's not good enough just to tell someone that. You need to also give them a bit of additional information, right? Is a batch yield of 26% going to come from that same system that has an average of 85? Or a batch yield of 100% or 99%, is that also reasonable to expect that? Well, we don't know. We need some other information to characterize our data. So the mean is just one of those ways. It just tells us where it's located. And then the spread, the variance, it's just a measure of how that is distributed around. Okay, so again, some more nomenclature. This curly or funny V is the variance of X, and it is by definition defined as the expected value of X minus the population mean. Can you square that expectation? Okay, and we'll call that for convenience sigma squared. And then, if we want to sample that variance, if we want to estimate, a sample estimate or statistic, S squared is the same looking thing. We take our individual x and subtract it from the estimated, and we take the sum of squares and divide it by n minus 1. So this is something you should be comfortable with. But just to think about it a minute, what is it doing? To calculate the variance, the sample variance, you actually have to know the mean ahead of time to form these differences. Why are we taking squares? Can't we just take absolute values? Why are we summing squares? Right, obviously, we have to take the sign information to come. We don't want a positive and a negative to cancel out. But why are we taking the sum of squares? Sorry? East mean squared, that's used, that's actually where the least squares comes from. Yeah. The truth is there isn't really any good reason for summing squares. We could have summed absolute values or something else. But for convenience, we use this because it's differentiable. We can make nice algebraic proofs using this terminology. The absolute value is not differentiable. It breaks down at the 0 point. So really, it's just for convenience that we're using the sum of squares. Then you could have used any sort of measure of spread, and there's many measures of spread that one can use to quantify the distribution. But yeah, the truth is, the sample variance is really easy to work with. There's a lot of good theoretical basis, theoretical proofs that come from assuming that as a reasonable measure of spread. But there is a whole body of statistical work out there that looks at alternative measures of spread and uses those instead. Then lastly, the degrees of freedom that we use in the denominator at n minus 1, that just comes from the fact that we've used up one degree of freedom to calculate the mean. What do I mean by that? This term over here, the equation for the mean, is a constraint. We're constrained by that equation. The sum of all our individual x's has to add up. The sum of the x's divided by small n has to add up to x bar. If I gave you, say, there's 100 data points of xi. If I gave you 99 of them and I gave you x bar, you could back calculate the other 100 points. Right? So that's what I mean by a constraint. The 100 points we've got have to obey that constraint. That's one degree of freedom that we remove from the system. We can't move our data around arbitrarily. We've got one fewer degree in which to use. But we'll come back to the terminology and explain it in a slightly different way later on. Now, outliers. How many of you have heard the term outliers? Okay, so you're pretty comfortable with it. It's, again, there's really not an easy definition for it. This is the best I can come up with. It's a point that's unusual given the context of the surrounding data. So that first sequence, they really just aren't that, there's no obvious outliers. If you look at that first line of data numbers, but if you look at the second line, you can spot the outlier quite quickly. Yet the number 4024 is the same number as incident first sequence. So 4024 by itself is not an outlier. A number or a measurement becomes an outlier given the context in which you find it. And in the last 3 weeks of the course, we'll extend that further. Here we're looking at one sequence of numbers, but we'll show actually, you won't even have to wait till then, you'll have to look in the monitoring section where we look at multivariate outliers, where a number doesn't stand out by itself, even in a single sequence, but it stands out when we look at multivariate. So that's what I mean by it. An outlier, it's unusual, but it needs context. Whether that context is one other variable, two or three other variables, it's always in context that you have to determine what an outlier is. Okay, medians. This is also something you should be familiar with, but I'll just point out something that you may not have seen before. So the median is calculated by sorting your data from smallest to largest, and you take the midpoint. Straightforward. Computer software does it nicely for you. And it's a measure of location. So it's an alternative way to quantify the location of the distribution. But how many of you have heard of robust statistics? Okay. Not many. One or two. So robust statistics is a whole other branch of statistical theory that looks at ways to calculate numbers that are insensitive to outliers. That's why I spoke about outliers just prior to this. So if you wanted to calculate the median of the second sequence over here, so calculate the median of that sequence, you'd sort the numbers from smallest to largest, and you'd pick the midpoint. And let's say, I don't know what it is, but let's say it's 52. Okay, that would be my median. What would be the mean? It's again the sum of those, but do you think the median is going to be 52? What is the mean going to be, relatively speaking? Higher. The mean is going to be biased upwards by this outlier, 4024. Because it's just, the mean is by definition just the sum of those numbers, so you're adding this big chunk, and then you're dividing by n, but your mean is going to be pushed higher than it really should be due to that outlier. Now, that's not entirely, it's not a hypothetical thing I'm talking about, because when I said earlier, this is real data we're dealing with. If you had to calculate the mean of that sequence, where would you place the mean? Yeah, someone from the back over there?
1680?
Where the mean lie there? The mean would be pushed higher by those spikes. It's going to be biased upwards by those higher spikes. Okay, maybe, I don't know how by how much, maybe 1700. I created this data synthetically. I know that what I intended the mean to be was 1680, but due to those spikes that I then added afterwards, it's going to be shifted up. The median, on the other hand, can be computed without you having to deal with the spikes and trying to eliminate it, and you'll get a good measure of location. So the median is a good alternative for location when you've got unusual data points in your sample. So Statistics Canada, and I'll get you to work on this in the exercises, for each riding in Canada when they're doing the elections, they don't report the average income. They report the median income for each riding in Canada. And you can think about that a bit, and we'll look at it in one of the assignment questions. Why would they use the median instead of the mean? Just another point, when we're talking about robust methods, one of the ways which we judge a robust method is by looking at the breakdown. The breakdown just means that, so let's look at your case of the median. It's got a breakdown of 50%. What that implies is that half the data needs to be contaminated before the statistic breaks down. So I can take up to 50% of my points, actually 50% minus one of my points, needs to be outliers before my median starts getting all screwed. I can work with the median with very highly contaminated data. The mean, on the other hand, has a breakdown of 1/n%. So if you've got n numbers, let's say 1,000 numbers, 1/1,000, you only need one of those numbers to be bad for your mean to be influenced. So you can have numbers that go 3, 5, 7, 2, 6, minus 4, minus 2, 10,000. Then that contaminated value of 10,000 is going to pull your mean right up. Whereas the median, you need half your numbers to be replaced by such nonsense values before your estimate of location is destroyed. So that's actually becoming increasingly common with the data sets we're dealing with, to see medians. And the next one, the measure of variance, measure of spread, the MAD, the median absolute deviation. So let's take a look at a bit of what this means. Let's unpack that equation. So the MAD is defined. The MAD for a sequence X, so I'm taking a sequence of numbers XI. The MAD is, take those numbers XI and subtract them from the median of the sequence first. Okay? So I'll go back to my series of numbers here. I will sort them from smallest to largest and I find the median, say 52. Then I go subtract every number in that sequence from 52. So 4 minus 52, 61 minus 52, 4,024 minus 52, and so on. So I get a whole new sequence of numbers. That's what that, this interior portion is. And then I go take the absolute values of those, right? And then I recompute the median of that sequence. So you can do this on the computer or by hand and just try it once or twice to get a feel for what's going on here. But what you get out of that at the end is a good measure of spread. And that constant C in front there is used so that if XI happens to be normally distributed already with no outliers. So in the unusual case that we have no outliers and we have a normal distribution already, that C just makes this value consistent with the standard deviation. You get the same result whether you use the standard deviation or the MAD on that case. So that correction factor is just to make it so that you can compare things. So the MAD is going to break down at 50% and the standard deviation, on the other hand, has a breakdown like the mean of 1/n%. So the MAD is, again, incredibly robust. In fact, it's the most robust estimate that you can have of location and of spread of the median and the MAD. There's no other, like, a 50% breakdown is the highest breakdown possible. You can't get greater than 50% breakdown. So these two estimates are really very good ways of estimating location spread. And for 600 level students or 400 level students that are interested, there's a reading assignment on a very good paper written for engineering people. So you can take a look at that. Okay, so that's a good point to take a break. Let's be back here at 5 to 4. What I'm focusing mainly on is when to use it and what that distribution looks like. So as I've noted, please consult any of the textbooks if you need more detail. I'm really just looking at the basics here for these distributions. Okay, so if you have a case where you have pass fail, or yes or no, so this is quite common for acceptance testing, which is you just have it at the end of your line, pass, fail, or yes or no, ship or no ship, or go to the second stage of production, or be recycled. It's a binary outcome. And the probability of pass plus the probability of fail has to add it to one. So here, for example, in a pharmaceutical line, they have a tableting device that compacts the powder into tablets, and some of the tablets break. So the proportion of acceptable tablets is 70%, and the proportion of broken tablets is 30%. So if we had this binary outcome, what would be the, for the case here where the probability of pass is 0.7, what would be the probability of seeing pass, pass, pass three times in a row? And discuss with your neighbor what would be the probability of seeing pass, fail, pass, fail, pass, fail. If you recall from your stats course, these are independent events that are occurring. We'll talk a bit about what independence means in a minute. But the probability of pass is 0.7, so seeing three sequential passes in a row is the product of those three, so it's about 30%, one third of the time. Actually, what's the probability of seeing fail, fail, fail? It's going to be 0.3 to 3, so it's going to be 0.027. Just 2.5%. Then again, pass, fail is 0.7 times 0.3, 0.7 times 0.3. It comes out to, I think, remember, just less than 1%. So this is, you see this all the time. People say, oh, we've had 5 sequential fails in a row on our line. Now you can use this knowledge to judge whether, what is the probability of that happening. They say 5 sequential fails, wow, that's really bad. The chance of that happening is impossible, whatever they'll say. No, you can actually quantify for a system where you know what the pass rate is and the failure rate is. You can quantify what is the likelihood of you seeing 5 sequential failures in a row. And then you can judge, okay, no, the equipment really is faulty, we need to replace it, or no, this could happen 3 out of 10, sorry, 3 out of 100 times, you could get this happening. The uniform distribution, like we saw earlier, the classic example is dice. The point is that each outcome is equally likely as any of the other outcomes. So here, for example, I've shown 4 defects. Defect A, B, C, and D are equally likely to occur due to whatever mechanism. We can get all 4 outcomes, and so you'd expect to see not a flat line, but a roughly flat line of those. Okay, now we get on to the main topic. So this is going to go from review to maybe a little bit further. But I expect most of you have covered the central limit theorem in the prior studies. So let's just take a look at what it says. We're not going to prove it. We're not going to do any proofs in this course of action. But we're just going to use the result that for the central limit theorem states the average of a sequence of values from any distribution, as long as that distribution has finite variance, that sequence of numbers that we take them independently. Again, we'll get back to what independence means in a second. But as long as we sample those values independently, we create the sequence X. The average of those values will approach the normal distribution. That's pretty interesting, right? Because there's many processes where we don't know what the distribution is. But as long as we're taking from them independent samples and we compute the average, that average is going to be more normally distributed than the original data. Let's take a look here at a case where I'm throwing dice again. So I've simulated this in R. I've thrown, I think, about 300 throws here, and that's the distribution from one die. So I'm throwing one die 300 times, and I get that typical uniform distribution. Now I take two dice, and I throw them, and I take the average of the two throws. Then I plot the distribution of the throws. I do it 4 times. Here's 6, here's 8, and here's 10. So as I'm summing, and well, because that's what averaging is, it's just a weighted sum, I'm throwing these things which I know to be uniformly distributed, and I'm adding them and computing the average, that average rapidly approaches the normal distribution. Usually no more than 7 or 8 summations are required to start approaching the normal distribution. That's actually quite interesting and quite powerful. And that's why central limit theorem plays such a central concept in the world of statistics, because it's applied so readily to most of the processes we deal with. We don't always know what the distribution is, where it comes from, but we do know that it's finitely distributed. Every engineering process we deal with is going to have a finite variance. Distributions with infinite variances are mainly a theoretical thing. But we'll find that our distributions are always finite variance. So if we take any of those independent samples and we add them up and compute the average, we're going to land up with a normal distribution at the end of that. Okay, so here's a little discussion on independence and what it means. So you may have seen this in previous course as well, but independence is so widely used in everything that we look at, in the least squares, in the central limit theorem requires independence, that we need to have a bit of a discussion about it. So independence says, let's take samples randomly from a population. And as long as we're taking them randomly, then they're independent. So that means, by saying that taking them randomly, you can imagine the classic case of a lottery, where you've got a big bin of numbers, you mix them up, and you take one sample out that bin. You mix them up, and you take another sample. You're taking sample 1 and sample 2 independently of each other. There's no way that sample 2 value can be affected by the sample 1's value, or vice versa, right? Not even slightly. There's absolutely no chance. That's what independence says. There's no effect from the value I take now and then the other value that I take after that, and the value I take the third one and the fourth one. These values that I draw from my population, they're independent of each other,
because we're taking them randomly. So if we frequently violate this perception, let's discuss with yourselves here these first four examples, or perhaps the first three, because the fourth one requires that I show you a chart. So discuss the first cases with each other. If I hand out a questionnaire to you, and there's several questions on there, but you can collaborate and discuss with yourself prior to giving me an answer, are those answers independent? Even if I ask 100 students and I give them a questionnaire, and they chat and discuss the answers, and I get 100 responses back, do I have 100 independent pieces of information? Then take a look at the snowfall example, under point 2 and point 3.
Okay.
And then we'll chat again in 2 minutes. So discuss this with each other what you think is independent. And you're collaborating and say, everyone is in a group of four. Even though I get back 100 questionnaires, because you worked in groups of four and maybe even just discussed it with each other, the four people in each group, they're going to have a similar sort of answer. So that data is going to be contaminated. In fact, I'll have 25 independent pieces of information, but not 100. Snowfall recorded in the last 30 days?
No, actually no.
No? Any other people? Any other?
I'd say, yes, independent. What does it matter what the snow was yesterday? It's a different day.
Okay, but anyone else?
Wouldn't the precipitation on one day impact the amount of water available for the next day?
Okay.
So then how much time do you need? You know, the next one is going to be asking about a year. Like, is a week enough?
Yeah. Well, we know that if there's snow today, there's some chance of snow tomorrow because the weather hangs around for a while. But you're right, it's also depends here on that time slot. We're looking at daily intervals. If we were hourly intervals, for sure you'd immediately say, no way, they're not independent. Because you know if it's snowing now, it's probably snowing an hour from now still. But you're right, a day from now, it's less likely. But still the fact is, if it's snowing today, it's likely to snow tomorrow. There's some chance, maybe 20%, but there's some relationship between today's value and tomorrow's value. So those data are not independent. Whereas the data taken on one day a year apart, that's clearly independent data. So, I want to show you now some data taken from batch reactors, and I want you to tell me which one is independent. Of those three sequences, are all of them independent, none of them, one of them? How can you judge independence if you look at data in this way, in time order, or in sequential characteristics? Is there any one of those sequences that seems more independent than the other?
Sample 3.
All three are independent?
No, sample 3 appears more independent than the other two.
Okay, so sample 3 appears more independent. Anyone from the back up over there? Which sample it seems the most independent to sorry? Anyone? Sample 1, 2, 3? But it's hard to tell. In fact, the fact that quite a few of us, I was reading an article on how to teach independence. There's statistical journals on how to teach statistics. And there's an article that says teaching independence. So I pulled it up and I'm like, okay, this seems interesting. The guy did something similar, except he strung beads on a row and asked him different colors, which ones are independent. But I thought, okay, let's take something more engineering related. And he said in his article, his classes always say sample 3 is more independent. In fact, it's the most non-independent because the way I constructed this data was as follows. I took random numbers, sequence of random numbers, and I said, let's call it xk. And then I said, a factor phi times xk minus 1. And I call this yk. So that's my output, yk. That's what I'm plotting as the y's. X is a number from the normal distribution. So I know those are independent. Then I said, let my output be that value plus some factor depending on just the previous sample. So if you look at those data, those three rows, those three charts there, if phi is zero, that would be the sample that's independent of each other, right? Because then each sample yk is only going to equal xk, and the xk we know are independent. Our source, the random number generator on my computer is, people do research on random number generators, and the R's random number generator is pretty good. It's independent data. So the xk's we know are independent. So for the case where phi is equal to zero, those are independent data. If phi is equal to 0.1, it says let 10% of the previous value, this should be yk. Yk minus 1. Sorry about that. So it says let's take 10% of the previous sample. Let's take 10% of the previous sample and add a random component to it, and then plot the sequence. Okay? Those data then are not independent. There's 10% carryover from the previous value. And in engineering, we call this a random walk. The output from this is a random walk. It moves all over the place. Because we're using the previous number to, it's like a drunk person walking. They take one step and then they randomly go, now I go randomly left to right. That's the random component. But if I'm already here, now I could be stumbling this way and that way and that way. You know, so I'm not going to put this in the video. But, so that's the purpose of a random walk, right? But when phi is non-zero, that's when the data are not independent. Which of the, what would you estimate the phi to be for sample 3?
Like 5.
Sorry?
Like 5.
Take a look at this. If we're looking at this, if the fact that it's oscillating in sample 3 indicates that if it was negative on the previous time, it's positive the next one. And then it's negative, and then it's positive. So visually, and this is what the article is saying, that people always take the samples that seem negatively correlated. In fact, for that case, phi is negative 0.6. People always take the case where there's negative correlation between the points and assume that they're independent because they look more random. You kind of see one is above, one is below, and you kind of think, okay, that looks more independent. It's not. In fact, it's more correlated. And then for sample 1 was 5 was equal to 0.4, and for sample 2, 5 was equal to 0. Sample 2 is actually an independent one in this case. So what I'm hoping to get from this is that you cannot judge independence just by looking at the data. Okay? There are statistical tests to verify if data are independent. Those are beyond what we're going to look at in this course. But I just want to point out, we're making this assumption. It's very difficult to look at the data and say these data appear independent. But we have to be aware that we're making that assumption. And the reason why I mentioned this in the context of the batches is, in chemistry processes, when we do system identification and we estimate what those values of phi are from data, they're always non-zero. Engineering processes move around in a correlated manner, in an autocorrelated manner. So this case here, the batches, is even if you don't clean out the batch reactor properly, after you produce the batch, there's some impurity left over or some material left over in the batch, that's going to carry on into the next batch. You're going to run the next batch in that same reactor. If you haven't cleaned that batch properly, that reactor properly, that second batch is going to be contaminated by the effect of the first one, to a small extent, and so on. So we get a lot of engineering data which are serially have that carryover there. And we call that batch-to-batch variation. And there's a whole body of work that looks at being able to predict what the next batch is going to do based on what the previous batch did. And this concept as well we'll cover in control charts of this carryover. But I want to point out that both data are seldom independent. We can't always assume that. Nevertheless, we do use it because the statistics are tolerant. These numbers that we calculate using the central limit here and so on, they tolerate some measure of independence, even if we of non-independence. Even though we have to assume to derive the central limit here on paper, in practice, if you do use non-independent data, it still works good enough. So you often hear statisticians say, no, your data are not independent. You really can't use any of our tools or our methods to go ahead. Well, no. A certain amount of non-independence can be tolerated. It's the same like the mean. You're not going to say, well, I can't calculate the mean because you have some outliers in the data. The mean is affected by the outliers to some extent, but it's not totally useless. Right? You can still get some sort of meaningful answer from your statistics, even if there is contamination, or even if you don't meet all the assumptions of the statistical method. So we'll see this again when we come to least squares. Least squares is a whole lot of a list of assumptions that your data need to be before you can use some of the outputs from a least squares model. But we're going to say, if you live in the real world, we don't always need those. We can still use it to some extent as long as we recognize where we're breaking it down. Okay, enough of that. Let's take a look at the normal distribution. So it's centered around zero, or some value u, but I've put u at zero, and our variable x is the one of interest, and p of x represents the probability of obtaining that value of x. So for example, at the zero point, the probability of getting exactly zero is roughly 40%. That's what you read off on the y-axis. The probability of obtaining a point at one sigma is roughly just below 0.3. And so on. So we're just reading off the probability of obtaining that x value. And it's symmetric. So the probability of one sigma is the same as minus one sigma. I'm not going to have you fill out this table. It's pretty straightforward. You can do it in your notes, but you can do it outside of the class. But what I was just getting at with this is four distribution centimeters with one sigma. Plot the values of 0, 1, and minus 1. And the idea is that you can see that they're symmetric. But what I'm interested in here is just some of these rules of thumb that I want you to remember. Sigma is the distance from the mean to the point of inflection. Okay, that comes from calculus. But the area from minus sigma to plus sigma, so going back, if I find the point here is 1 sigma, the area between that point is 70%. Of my values fall under that mean. It seems a little bit too big a number, but it is roughly just over 2/3 of your data will fall between plus or minus one sigma. And the two sigma limits, they fall 95% of the total area under that graph. So any number between plus two sigma and minus two sigma, between this range here and there, from here to there, that covers 95% of the area. So this tail from 2 up and from minus 2 back down, that covers 5% of the area. So those are numbers that are rules of thumb. We'll use that a lot, and we'll see that in the least square section especially. Okay, so I want you to remember those numbers specifically. The plus or minus one sigma and the plus or minus two sigma, and their corresponding area. Because when people talk of normal distributions, they'll talk about the mean and the variance, and it will give you a very good idea of what range of the data it's covering, if you have those in the head. Now, in other courses, you may have had to look at these monster tables of normally distributed values in the back of a textbook or wherever you find them. I'm not going to deal with tables. We're moving to computer systems where we'll get the software to calculate it for us and more accurately. But I do want to show you what the principle is behind those tables, because you may find yourself having to use them. And this principle is widely used in other areas of the course as well. So there's no way we can tabulate all distributions, all normal distributions, right? So you could have a system that's operating at a 50%, say 50%, and then your standard deviation is 16%. So there's not a table for mean of 50 standard deviation 16. Right? There's just too many combinations there. So there's this concept of creating a unit normal distribution, which just says, let's transform your data. Take your x and subtract the mean and divide by the standard deviation. And call that variable z. That variable z, I don't think I've mentioned, no, it's not mentioned yet, it's probably not mentioned in your notes either. That z also is not normally distributed. But that's the key thing. It's not, oh, it is here. It's normally distributed with a mean of 0 and variance of 1. So, for example, if x was originally measured in kilograms, what is the units of z? That requires that you know what the units of sigma are. The units of sigma are the same as the units of x. So it's that's why I like to use standard deviation rather than variance. The standard deviation is in the units of the variable we're talking about. So standard deviation sigma is got the same unit as the variable x usually. So if we're dividing through there, the units cancel out. So z is dimensionless. That's great because it allows us to compare. So one, remember, if we started this class, I said one of the purposes of this class today is to quantify variation and also compare variation. So we can compare variables. The moment we go to z, the z form, I can compare two arbitrary things to each other by just comparing the z value because now I'm in dimensionless units. Another nice reason for that is, say, for example, you are working in kilograms, but your colleagues in the United States are working in pounds. That Z transformation is scale independent. If you decided to work in kilograms or in pounds, you would get the same Z values at the end of it. So the units cancel out, and so that's another nice reason for using that. The units are totally dimensionless. And then, I'd like just to make this recommendation that even though we're looking at just using the software, I want you still to go open a textbook at the back and look at those appendices and see that you can duplicate the numbers in the tables. Just so, firstly, that will prove to yourself that you can read the table, but then secondly, that you can make the computer system match up with what the table is giving. So I highly recommend that you do that. Okay, so what I'm going to have you do is I can give you numbers from the computer, but I want you to do these two exercises. Assume in the first case you've got the biological activity of the drug, and it's measured in whatever units. It's normally distributed with a mean of 26.2 and variance of 9.2. So the first number is the mean, the second number is the variance. What is the probability of finding the biological activity based on the variance? And in the second example, you don't need a computer. You should be able to calculate by hand that what is the proportion of field values between 77 and 93% when our batch process is operating in such a normal distribution. Okay, so between yourselves for the next 5 minutes, answer these two questions. This is straightforward application of the Z transform over here. If you need any values from the computer, I can read them off to you. Okay, so just walking around the room here, I see a few concerns. Firstly, when we talk about normal distribution and we use this notation at the end, I'm saying that's 26.2, and that is 9.2. It's usually this is the mean, and this is the variance, sigma squared, not the standard deviation. So that's the variance. That's why in the second question I'd say, call it 16% squared. It seems a little weird to talk of squared percents, but that's the notation. Okay, so that's the first issue. we say it's normally distributed. So the data is going to look, the population is going to look like this. The mean of the distribution is 26.2. Okay, and I'll just mark here that this is my axis in terms of x. I'm looking in the x direction. And my variance is 9.2, or the sigma is going to be roughly 3 units. So give or take, it's going to be roughly 3. What is the probability of seeing an x smaller than 30? Oh, I said 9.2 is the standard deviation. Okay, sorry about that. Yeah, so the variance should be 9.2. The standard deviation is the square root of that. Sorry about that. So probability of x less than 30, we'll do it graphically, is 9.2 over here. So any x smaller than 30 is going to be just cumulative area. So we know that one sigma is here at, that's 3 units away, so 26.2 plus 3 is going to be 29.2. That value there is 29.2. So 30 is just beyond it. So it's going to be just beyond the one sigma region. Okay? This is this area. Now we know that before I go to the computer or before I go to statistical tables or anything, let's just get an estimate for our. So the area from the mean back to minus infinity is 0.5. Okay, we know that. We know that the area between minus sigma and plus sigma is 70%. Okay, so this area of this piece here is 0.7. The area, anything to the left of that is 0.5. But we're not really interested in this area of 0.7. We're interested in half of that. So take half of that. That's going to give us one half of this rectangular area between, between 26.2 and 29.2. That area is going to be 0.35 plus 0.5. So I'm expecting a ballpark value of around 85%. If I didn't have a computer handy, that's why I want you to know the rules of thumb, just so that you have a good feeling for what these distributions mean. But also, the reason why I put this exercise is just a bit of a refresher of how we can add and subtract areas, right? So is everyone clear on what I've done here? Why I've taken half of 0.7, is that clear? No. Okay, I've taken 0.7 to be the area from minus sigma to plus sigma. That's from our rule of thumb. I'd said there earlier that it's on the previous slide, but anything between minus sigma and plus sigma is always going to represent 70% of your area. But we're not interested in that. We're interested in just this piece from the mean up to one sigma. So that's half of 0.7. So that's where I get to 0.35. Then the plus 0.5 is, because the distribution is symmetric about the mean, this total area from the mean up to minus infinity, that area has to be 0.5. And the area from the mean up to plus infinity is 0.5. Okay, so we're interested in this area, this total area here, plus this portion up to 1 sigma. So 0.85. So that's what we expect roughly as the probability. Okay, is that clear? Now, I'm going to try and get a more accurate answer using computers or tables. Okay. With R, you don't need to go to the Z like I showed. But for tables, you definitely have to go. Because there isn't a table for a mean of 26.2 and variance 9.2 that shows you areas. You have to go to the Z domain. So let's go to the Z domain. Now watch what I do here. All that Z does is it changes your axis. It doesn't change the Y axis. It only changes the X axis. So I raise the X axis, and I now call this Z. This is not 26.2 anymore, it's 0. And that sigma now is plus 1. And that point is just beyond plus 1. But nothing is different. Going to the Z system just changes your X axis. The distribution looks the same. But I'm just going to what's called a standardized distribution, or the unit distribution. Because my mean is now at 0, my sigma is at 1. So if you calculate the Z value for 30, you say 30 minus the mean divided by sigma is 30 minus 26.2 divided by the square root of 9.2. That will give you your Z value, whatever that is. Then you look up on a table in the back of any of these textbooks, and these tables show you, they're constructed as follows. They will show you something like this. They'll draw a normal distribution, and they will say, they'll draw an arbitrary line, and they'll call that Z. And they will give you numbers for Z, and at each Z, they'll show you the area. So as, say, Z is minus 5, your area is almost non-existent. Then Z is minus 4, minus 3, minus 2, minus 1. When Z is 0, your area is 0.5. Then the tables go on, up and up to different values of Z. That's why the Z transform is so useful. Because once we're in standardized units, we have to only have one table handy and look up cumulative areas, cumulative from negative infinity up to whatever Z. You can keep going, okay? So let's take a look at how that looks in the software. I'm just gonna start out here. Okay, so in R, the function to calculate what the cumulative area is, I always get this wrong, so I'm going to test it first.
P norm in the notes.
P norm. Because there's so many more. I'll explain the R's thinking. It's just off the top of my head, I don't remember. So I always just try it on the P norm shows the cumulative area from negative infinity up to Z equals 0. So P norm from negative infinity up to minus 1 is 15%. The area from negative infinity up to 1 is 84%. So let's just use those few numbers and quickly construct. And I'll show you how I got to that 70% thing, that rule of thumb of 70%. Well, constructing that, here Z equals 0. So P norm of 0 is 0.5. It says the cumulative area from negative infinity to point to 0 is a half. So that's half the area. P norm of minus 1 is 1 sigma down. So I go back 1 sigma. The cumulative area from negative infinity to minus sigma on the Z scale is 15, let's say 15%. Okay, so this area here from negative infinity is 15%. Then P norm of plus 1 is the area from negative infinity to 1 sigma out this way. So that's 80, let's say 85%. So the total area, now I'm adding all of this and this, that area is 85%. So I got the 70% by saying 85% minus 15%. So it's take this whole area minus that tail. Now it just gives me the area between plus and minus 1 sigma. Okay, so there's plus sigma, minus sigma. So 85% minus 15% is 70%. Give or take. So that's where I got that 70% rule of thumb from. So Z value for this case was equal to 30 minus 26.2 divided by square root of 9.2. Okay, so Z was 1.25, is that right? And then I say p-norm of that. So in R you can nest things, because you haven't seen this before, you can just write things around it. So p-norm of all of that mess, 0.89. So we weren't far off with our estimate of 85%, 89%. So that's how you're doing this software. Okay. Next question. Now you're easy. Now you don't even need a computer for this one. This one is so straightforward, you can do it quickly. 2 minutes. Assume x equals the yield from the batch post to the batch distribution. Calculate for me what proportion of the yield values lie between 77 and 93%. Okay, let's go. The mean is at 85, the standard deviation is 4 units, so this is in x variables. And we want to find the proportion between 77 and 93. We want to find the area between that, so we want to know that. So going to z units says, so z, let's go z or b for the lower bound for 77 is minus 85 divided 4, which is, okay. So in z units, so all we do is we just change our x-axis. That becomes minus 2 sigma. That's minus 2 sigma, but we want to actually find minus 2. And then the z for the upper bound. So what's the area? Oh. 95%. Okay, no need even for computers. Okay. Is this data normally distributed? That's the next section. We're always referring, this is not new. For example, this previous exercise on those areas, that's something I would have expected you to have covered in a previous course. This is moving on to something that you have. Is this data normally distributed? Distributed, yes. One person, not normally distributed. A handful. Okay. I forget. I drew this picture late last night, so I don't know what it was. I think it was not normally distributed. But the point that I want to make is that for small samples of data, you cannot tell just even by looking at the data. But we're going to use, and I'm going to derive here for you a way that will test for normality. Because so many of these methods assume that we know what the mean is, that we know what the standard deviation is of a normal distribution, but we seldom ever check, is it likely that this data ever could come from a non-normal distribution? And it's more than likely that our data that we deal with does not come from a normal distribution. So this way is a way to check for it. Now as I go through the derivation, if you don't get all the details, don't worry, go through it in the notes. What I'm more interested in is that you understand how to interpret the plot that we get to at the end. This is not a plot, this is an intermediate step I want to talk about. But the final plot that I show you to assess normality, that's what I want you to be interested in. The mechanics of getting there is of interest, but not the 15. Okay, so to understand how the next section works, I need to just introduce some two terms. The cumulative distribution, which we've seen already, is the total area underneath the distribution function up to a certain point. So what I plotted here, I plotted the normal distribution, and I've integrated it. So I'm taking my z value and I'm integrating. So up to minus 2, the total area is that. It would be about 2.5%. Then I go to minus 1. Then the total area there should be just under minus 1 is going to be there. Total area is going to be about 15%. Up to 0, this value is 50%. So I'm just plotting the integrated area from minus infinity up to whatever value of z. Now this figure does look a little bit different to that in your printed notes. And I think in the printed notes I call this x, but really it's z. And then so on. So as of course, as we get up to very high numbers, the total area under the normal distribution is going to be 1. So we get this S-shaped curve. And you'll see this using other areas as an S-curve. Now, in R, I've shown the two functions that go between the two. If you know what z is, and you want to get the cumulative area, you use p-norm. That's the one we just used a minute ago in the software. If you happen to know the cumulative area, and you want to get back to the corresponding z value, you use the q-norm function. So you say q-norm of 0.5, it's going to give you 0. Or q-norm of 0.8, it's going to give you some high-ish number over there. So going backwards from the knowing the area to the z value is called the inverse cumulative distribution. And then going forwards is just the cumulative distribution. Now to check for normality, we take the following approach. Assume two data sets. For the first data set, we'll take it that from the theoretical normal distribution, we'll actually use truly normally distributed numbers. Although the actual mechanics don't really ever get to use the numbers, but we're making the assumption that the first data set is truly from the normal distribution. Then the second data set is the numbers we want to test. We compute certain quantities in the first data set, compute certain quantities in the second data set, and then we plot the two computed quantities against each other. And if they match, then we say, there is no evidence, standard statistical jargon, they never want to commit themselves to anything. There is no evidence that the data is not normally distributed. So anyway, it says, we've got nothing to prove that this data is not normally distributed. Okay, it's normally distributed. But if you see that there's some discrepancy between these two quantities we calculate, then you say, well, now we have evidence that these data are not normally distributed. So that's the mechanics behind this technique. Do one on the normal distribution, do the other one on the actual data, and compare. So what do we do on the normal distribution data? Sort them from smallest to largest, and then we calculate various quantiles. The first, you sort the data. We say, for example, here I take n data points. The first point, 1 over n, that represents the 1 over n times 100 percentile. You remember the percentile is the point below which that much of the data lies. So the 50th percentile is the point where below which half our data lies. The 10th percentile is the point below which we have 10% of our data. So if I sorted my data from smallest to largest, the first point is, by definition, the first 1 over n percentile. The second point is the 2 over n percentile. The midpoint is the 50th percentile. And the last point is the 100th percentile. This is for purely theoretical normal distribution. And then what I do is I calculate those theoretical points on that distribution function. I'll show that how to do that. So think of it, what is the 50th percentile? I said that's the point below which 50% of our data should lie. So if I have a data set of 10,000 points, and I've got my 50th percentile, 5,000 of my data points should lie below that. Coming back to this graph, if I have a point and I know If I, what is my 50th percentile? It's the point below which 50% of my data lies. So I'm saying I go here. Here's my point, 0.5. I come across, and I come down. On the Z scale, my 50th percentile should be 0. Is that clear? The 75th percentile, or actually, yeah, the 85th percentile, remember 85% of the value should lie below plus 1. So all I do is I form a set of equally spaced percentiles on this axis, and then I bring them over and I come down, and I find what the equivalent Z scores are. Okay, so that's going to be the quantity I'm going to compute. Do I go over the R code for it? No, let me just skip over that and then I'll come back to it. Okay, now let's do the equivalent for the normal, for the actual data. So we take our actual data and we sort them from smallest to largest. Well, before we sort them, it doesn't matter, we can do the sorting first or last, but the key thing is we standardize the data first. So we subtract the mean and we divide by the standard deviation. In other words, we use our actual data and we form the Z values for the actual data. Each data point, we get its corresponding Z value. Then we can sort the Z values. Okay. If those data come from a normal distribution, they should have the same or similar Z values to that from the theoretical distribution. So that's all we need. We're plotting basically, and that's some R code, but let's go back here. Actually, I'm going to do this in R, maybe it would help you to see that there. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take n values, and I'm going to calculate what those corresponding okay, so what I've done here is I've taken this axis. I've gone on this y-axis, and I've taken 10 equally distributed points between 0 and 1. Then I come across and I read each of those 10 points down on the corresponding z-axis. So I get 10 z-values, which I know come from a normal distribution. Then I take my real data and I do the same thing. I calculate the z-values. Actually, maybe easier than I just showed it here. So let's take 10 real values, for example. The full rate is shown in the notes. I compute the mean and I compute the standard deviation. And then I calculate the yield z values by subtracting off the mean and dividing by the standard deviation. So now I get my same data, so 86.2 in z form is 0.73. 85.7 is 0.64. 71, maybe I don't have this in the same order, but the idea is that this number corresponds to that z. And then I sort the z from low to high. Now notice what happens is, These data actually do come from a normal distribution. What happens is, when I compare the calculated value to the theoretical value, there's pretty close agreement, one for one. And all I do is I plot those quantities against each other on the scatter plot. That's what you're seeing here in the next figure. And if that forms a 45 degree line, the data are normally distributed. Or you don't have any evidence to say that they are not normally distributed, as statisticians like to say. If there's significant deviation from that 45-degree line, then you know that these data are not normally distributed. And that's so more than the mechanics of getting to it, if you're interested, I put the R code here for you. But if you're really not interested in how you get to that, if you don't need to sort the Z values and calculate them, you can just use this function, QQ norm between R, and it will do all the calculations and display the plot for you. This is what you get. But the way to read it is that on the x-axis, it's showing the data from the normal distribution, and on the y-axis, it's showing you your data. And if there's close agreement, then you know what your data are normally distributed. Okay? Is there any uncertainty about that? How to read that plot? So in the exercises, I'll have you look at assessing whether the website data, the website visits, do they follow a normal distribution? Maybe they don't, because we know that certain days of the week we have many fewer visitors than other days of the week. So do we expect the website data to follow a normal distribution? Well, probably not, but we can actually test it by showing a plot like this. Okay. So, yeah, it's almost coming to an end here. So I'm not going to get into the t-distribution. We'll leave that for next week. But what I do want to go into is the software. I just want to do for 5 to 10 minutes, just quickly show some things about the software. I think that you have got the R stuff working. You didn't need it for the first assignment, but have most of you got the software working? Okay, have you seen in TinR how you can get the, when you write your code up here, how it reads it down there for you? Okay, so the point of TinR is, and one of the reasons why I use R for this course is that you can document your data analysis. The way you do that is you write your data analysis up here in a text file. So let's go File, New. Well, firstly, let's just start everything. So you start TinR. And you also start R itself. So it will arrange the two side by side. You go File, New. And then you can say, for example, fields for my batch is equal to combination 10, 45, 23, 66, whatever. We're creating a small vector of field values. And then fields by mean is equal to mean. And the idea is that you go save this data, save the script. So let's call it test. And if later on you want to try the same script with new field values, say you want to change the data, or you realize you made a mistake and that was actually 52, you don't need to rewrite all the steps in R. You write it here in TinR, and it transfers those data, those instructions down to R and shows the answer. So you do that with this icon over here. The first one, the green light, the white one is just sends the data file to R and doesn't show you any of the steps. And the green one copies the whole file down to R, but shows you the steps. So let's, if you click on that, it basically sends that information as if you had typed it in R. Okay? Then you can go down here and see, okay, fields.green is equal to that. But you didn't have to type it in R. You just kind of use R as your engine that does the number crunching, but you write the instructions in TinR. Then later on, I can come replace that with a whole different vector of data, maybe 10,000 data points, but I don't have to rewrite my instructions in R. So this is your documentation of the work you've done. So that's the concept. Now also, it gets a little bit tedious. Say you want to just change one line. Say here, I can add a new line. Yield.sd is equal to standard deviation of the yields. Say, for example, these first two lines took 100 seconds to compute, which may not be unreasonable for large data sets, but for this small data set, sorry, it's trivial. But say you've already done the first two lines. You don't want to rerun the whole script every time you make a small change. So there's this, these second two icons, which will just send the selection. So anything that I've selected in TinR goes down. So if I click that, it just sends that additional line down to R. So it's a bit of a debugging tool for you to iterate that thing. That's why you need to install both packages. Okay, so any questions to wrap up?